We want to talk about why atoms bond and how they bond and the different types of bonds they form. Atoms form bond because most atoms are electrically unstable. In other words, their electron cloud is not stable the way it is. This is because they do not have a full octet, meaning that they do not have 8 valence electrons. The exception to this, of course, is the noble gases. These atoms are very stable. They have 8 valence electrons and they tend not to form bonds. Bonding is one way that atoms become stable. And by doing this, they create all of the compounds and molecules in existence. Electrons are moved around, but the matter is never gained or lost. So we adhere to the law of conservation. Remember that matter and energy cannot be created or destroyed. So even in the bonds, we're shifting electrons around sometimes, but the electrons don't go away. Atoms bond when the electrons from each atom are attracted to the nuclei of another atom. So for example, if we have atom A and atom B, and they're relatively far apart, then they're sort of here, and they have some amount of energy. We're going to call this the baseline, so we'll say this is zero energy. This is their normal state. But if they're close enough together, the electrons from this atom, from atom A, are also attracted to the protons in atom B, and vice versa. This starts to pull the atoms closer and closer together until eventually their electron clouds sort of merge so that the electrons can be attracted to both nuclei at the same time. At this point, they are here at point X. So they are here on this energy curve where their energy is very low. The lower the energy, the more stable the situation. So when the atoms bond and form that energy low, they're very stable and this is the preferred state. Again, we have to follow the law of conservation. So this energy that was released goes somewhere. It's not just gone forever. It's released out into the world. And that is why reactions sometimes feel hot, because when those bonds are formed and release energy, we sometimes feel it as heat. If they get too close together, then their nuclei start to repel. So electronegativity becomes really important here. And we have three situations. We could have two atoms that both have low electronegativity, or we could have two atoms that both have high electronegativity, or we can have one atom that has low electronegativity and one that has high. We're going to look at each of those situations separately. We'll start with, what if everyone has low electronegativity? In that case, no one is really attracting the electrons very well. Nobody has the ability to pull the electrons into their own cloud. So we end up forming the sea of electrons. We call these delocalized electrons. That is the chemistry like big people word. But the cutesy description is a sea of electrons. And I'll show you why that's the description in just a minute. Now, if we're talking about atoms with low electronegativity, that means we're talking about metals. This explains why metals can conduct electricity so well, because they already have electrons that are not being very well held. And so extra electrons in the form of electricity can easily jump in and move through them. What if everyone has high electronegativity? That means that both atoms, everyone involved in that bond, can pull the electrons into their own electron cloud. And none of those atoms are really able to steal the electrons away from another atom. So they're going to have to share the electrons. Sometimes they're moving in one cloud, sometimes in another. Those clouds kind of merge. If we're talking about atoms with high electronegativity, that means we're talking about non-metals. When non-metals bond, this is called a covalent bond, and it forms a covalent molecule. What if there's a big difference, though? What if one atom has low electronegativity and one has very high electronegativity? In that case, the atom that is very electronegative can attract the electrons away from the atom with very low electronegativity. So one atom can totally pull the electrons away from the other atom, stealing the electrons. This happens when metals bond to nonmetals, because we know metals have very low electronegativity and nonmetals have very high electronegativity. The metals will lose their electrons and form positive cations, while the nonmetals gain those electrons, forming negative anions. Now they are held together, not because the electrons are attracted to both atoms, but because you've created positive and negative ions. And those positive and negative ions are now attracted to each other. This is called an ionic bond because it's a bond between ions. So there are three ways this bonding can happen. By allowing the electrons to move freely among all of the atoms because no one attracts them very well, we call that a metallic bond. By sharing electrons, because everyone attracts the electrons and nobody can take them away from the other, we call this a covalent bond. And then by exchanging electrons, where one atom is able to totally steal the electrons away from another atom, we call this an ionic bond. Let's take a minute to talk about metallic bonding specifically. In metallic bonding, we end up with these electrons that are just sort of free floating around. So these electrons are moving all throughout the structure, but they're not necessarily attached to any one nucleus. So we've got positive nuclei and negative electrons just moving all around. And that's where that phrase sea of electrons comes from. Remember that we're going to describe these electrons as delocalized, but the term sea of electrons is often used. This happens between two metals, neither of which is really able to pull those electrons in. This structure is what gives metals their characteristic properties of conductivity. If we add in another electron here in the form of electricity, it could easily join this little situation and move around all among the atoms because nobody is really holding on to the electrons anyway. Malleability, meaning the ability to be hammered flat, we could do that. We could hammer, put pressure right here, and move this little nucleus over there. It really doesn't matter because the electrons are just generally attracted to these positive nuclei, but the nuclei can move around if you put enough force on them. Ductility is the same thing. That's the ability to be pulled into a wire, and it's for the same reason. Those nuclei can be moved around within that structure, and the electrons can just fill in the gaps. And then the high melting or boiling points. This is because all of these nuclei are attracted to all of these negative electrons. Not so attracted they hold on to them tightly, but attracted enough that they stay close to them. So while we can move the nuclei around within that structure, it's going to take a lot of energy to pull the nuclei apart and make them spread out and melt. It's going to take a lot of energy, thus the high melting and boiling points. Ionic bonding occurs between a cation and an anion. This usually is a metal and a nonmetal. There are a couple of exceptions, which we'll talk about, but generally speaking, we have a metal and a nonmetal. The metal is going to give up all of its valence electrons to the nonmetal. So the metal forms a cation and the nonmetal forms an anion. This attraction between the positive and negative charges of the cation and the anion are what hold this structure together. Although in the previous picture, we saw one sodium atom giving up all of its valence electrons to one chlorine atom, it doesn't have to be that ratio. Here we've got magnesium. It needs to give up two valence electrons, so it can give one up to one chlorine atom and one up to another chlorine atom, forming two chlorine anions and one magnesium cation, but still those forces of attraction between the cations and anions are there, holding that whole structure together. And in fact, this will happen repeatedly. It forms what's called a lattice. This lattice is a repeating pattern of positive and negative, positive and negative, positive and negative, over and over and over again, so that there are forces of attraction in all directions. So it's a very strong structure, which explains why it has a high melting point and is very hard, because many, many forces of attraction are formed and in all directions, creating this crystal lattice that's very strong. Again, we don't have to have a one positive and one negative ion situation. We could have one cation and two anions. Here we've got calcium giving up two electrons to two chlorines. So the structures can be a little bit different, but notice that this chlorine is attracted to this calcium, to this calcium, to this calcium. And the calcium is attracted to this chlorine, but also is attracted to this chlorine and to this chlorine and to this chlorine. So there are forces of attraction in all directions, making that structure very sturdy and strong and very hard to pull all of those ions apart to melt that structure. The lattice explains the properties of ionic compounds. They have really high melting points because of those many, many, many forces of attraction. They're also hard for the same reason and brittle. If we were to break them, they're going to cleave right along this line. They're not going to be squishy at all. They're going to break along lines. Because of the positive and negative ions, ionic compounds dissolve in water fairly easily. And when they do, they dissociate. This means that the positive ion and the negative ion will move apart and water will be able to get in between. The fact that this happened, that the ions dissociate and move freely around in the water, allow it to conduct electricity now. It does not conduct electricity as a solid, but it will as a liquid if you could get it to melt, or as a solution. Because in those two situations, the ions are able to move around. Covalent bonding occurs between two or more nonmetals. In this case, everyone has really high electronegativity, so they're very able to pull those electrons in, and they end up having to share the electrons. So the electron clouds end up sort of overlapping, and the electrons are attracted to both nuclei. That's what holds them together, this electrostatic attraction between the nucleus and the electron clouds of both atoms. So when that happens, both atoms feel like they have 8 electrons. On its own, a chlorine atom has only 7 valence electrons. But if it can share an electron from another chlorine atom, then it feels like it has its original 7 plus an extra 1 to make 8. And this chlorine atom feels the same way. It has its original 7 plus this extra 1 from the red chlorine to make 8. So both of them feel like they have 8 because they are sharing some of the electrons. Covalent molecules do not form lattices. They form individual molecules that are not bonded to each other. They may interact with weaker forces of attraction, but the individual molecules are separate and they remain separate. This is why it's easy to melt them, because in order to pull this molecule away from this molecule and away from this molecule, we only have to overcome these weak interactions, not strong bonds. Therefore, covalent molecules tend to have very low melting points. They also do not conduct electricity very well because there are no positive and negative pieces to them. These are all just neutral atoms that are bonding together and sharing electrons. There are several diatomic atoms. These are atoms that always bond with something. So if they're not bonded with some other element, they will double themselves up. These are the 7 diatomic atoms. If you look on the periodic table and start with number 7, that's nitrogen, they are going to make a 7, and there are 7 of them if we remember to add hydrogen, which is always our problem child and not where we want it to be. It does not help form this number 7, but it is part of the diatomic 7. So there are 7 diatomic atoms: nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, and hydrogen. They will always be bonded to something. In other words, if we take nitrogen, for example, nitrogen could be bonded to oxygen, or it could be bonded to sodium. But if it isn't bonded to some other element, then it will bond with another atom of itself. The same is true for all diatomic atoms. Covalent molecules can be rather simple, just H2O or NH3 or CH4, simple molecules, but they can also be very, very complex. They can form fats and DNA and proteins and things where these structures are very large and have lots and lots of atoms involved. So that makes covalent molecules very interesting because they can take a lot of different forms and have a lot of different purposes. So here's just a little summary, a side-by-side of each type of bond and the properties associated with it. Metals, remember, have positively charged nuclei, so cations, surrounded by a sea of delocalized electrons. This is because metals have very low electronegativity and all of them want to lose electrons. None of them want to gain. This makes them very good conductors of electricity and have high melting and boiling points. Covalent compounds form individual molecules. These are composed of nonmetals, all of which have high electronegativity, all of which want to gain electrons. So they have to share the electrons. Because there's no positive and negative pieces, they are poor conductors of electricity. And because they are individual molecules, we can separate them easily, meaning they have a low melting and a low boiling point. Ionic compounds form between a metal and a nonmetal. The metals tend to have low electronegativity and easily lose electrons, where the nonmetals have high electronegativity and easily gain electrons. So the metal ends up completely transferring its electrons to the nonmetal, forming a metallic cation and a nonmetallic anion. Because they do have these positive and negative pieces, they conduct electricity well when they are dissolved or melted. Remember that those positive and negative ions must be able to move around in order to conduct electricity. Because of the lattice structure that they form, they have very high melting points and very high boiling points because there are forces of attraction in all direction and between many, many different ions.